Well, hello again, and welcome to another episode of the Hyperion Adventures Podcast. I'm Tom. As always, I'm with my gorgeous, super intelligent, and the person who loves your questions more than I do, my co-host and wife, Michelle.
Hi, everybody. Thanks, sweetie. Although I have to admit, you know, I know you've seen most of the questions. I have a few that you haven't seen, but not as many. I know. So I'm like, my heart's kind of going like this.
Oh, it's going to be fine. our listeners are very good.
They're wonderful. Yeah. They're wonderful.
So
don't want to disappoint, yes. You know, lame answer.
So obviously, this is kind of a leading into what our episode is going to be, and we'll get to that in just a second. But first, we want to say we're recording this episode on Sunday, March 29th, 2020. We're kind of back on to schedule here after our vacation, after our week back. We're back to recording on Sundays, and putting them out back on Sundays. And we appreciate that you joined us today. In the future, you can find us most everywhere you get podcasts. However, the very best place to find us is on our own website, HyperionAdventuresPodcast.com. And while you're there, why don't you just go ahead and sign up for the newsletter?
Yeah, it's a great way that we can share some more information with you, some things that are coming up. And I'll tell a little bit about something that we're going to add in my tip today.
Oh, that'll be interesting. Mm. So, wow.
I know. Don't you love it when I haven't told you yet what you got to add to the
newsletter? That hasn't happened today at all. Well, I love that too. You know, by the way, I'm going to put this in the notes for the episode and for the newsletter and everything. I'm like, oh, here comes some more work for me. I can't wait. Thanks, honey.
Just enriching
appreciate
it.
Appreciate that. No, it's all good. Definitely all good. Of course, you if you want to follow us on social media, and we got a lot of input on today's show from social media. Yes, thank you all. Thanks to all of our followers, and hopefully you will soon become a future follower. On Twitter, we are at Hyperion Podcast, Facebook, Instagram, and Pinterest at Hyperion Adventures Podcast. And we did get some questions today from email. If you ever want to email us for any reason, including like topics, questions outside of this show, whatever the case may be, you can always email us at HyperionAdventuresPodcast@gmail.com.
Right, and thank you again for everybody who has been reaching out to us with some of your questions through all types of social media and email. That's been great. And we always love hearing from people, whichever way, whether it's through social media or on our Gmail account. We love hearing from people and getting some information from you of how things are going. But most of all, we are so appreciative when we get some feedback through a review or a rating. And that's always amazing when we get that.
Yeah, speaking of that, we've gotten some really nice reviews recently, and we just received one just this last week. And this was really nice. It said, the headline on it was truly a delight. Just found this podcast a few weeks ago, needing a pick-me-up. I've never been to a Disney park, but hope to someday. And this fills the gap for me with great upbeat Disney, y'all, until I can experience it for myself. And that is from Hanner's Bananier, I believe. I apologize if I got your handle there incorrect. But thank you so much for the wonderful review. We really appreciate every single one of these we get. Again, it helps us do so much better, know how we're doing out there as a podcast. It helps us know that that you appreciate what we're doing, but also it helps other people kind of find this podcast. There's some sort of thing out there that I don't quite understand, some algorithm,
really?
Some sort of I know, something that I don't understand. What's that? That helps
just
when
kidding.
People are searching for Disney podcasts, when you get more reviews, that kind of drives you up the charts a little bit so people can find you easier. And everybody who chimed in and has done that so far, and many of you have, and again, we really, really appreciate it. That has helped us, grow as a podcast in many, many ways.
Most definitely. And it's really so nice to hear all those warm wishes and, great feedback. It's so touching that you feel that way. And wow, I always get excited about somebody who hasn't been to Disney. That's the person I want to go to Disney with, you know, see it new through their eyes. But if anybody ever wants some tips or, you know, some help with planning a trip, let us know. It's a fun thing that we love to get involved in.
Yeah, we do. Too much, as our friends and family will tell you at times. You like to get involved too much with our Disney stuff. Part of the reason why we started this podcast is because, you know, they were like, okay, we're tired of listening to you. So we were, instead of them listening to us, we put it out there for you to listen to us. And thankfully, you've decided that you enjoy this. So we really appreciate that. So lots of stuff for you today, but most important thing is going to be our main topic of the week. And it really involves you, the listener, because you really helped us out with this one. And we've been kind of touting it for a couple weeks now, as far as this was going to be something that we wanted you all involved with. And that is going to be our Ask Us Anything episode. We're going to tell you, okay? Okay, we're going to tell you, all right? No, really, we have an assortment of questions from a lot of our listeners. They have some things that are a little deep, some things that are mostly just fun about Disney, and some things that they wanted to know about us personally. Who are you? So that's why we opened it like that. But we're going to have a lot of fun today and answer some of your questions. And of course, just because we're putting these questions out today, if you ever want to know anything about us, we're pretty much an open book. You can email us. Well,
and not an interesting open book either.
I guess you can judge for yourself today. If you ever want to hit us up on social media or email on other times, and we'll probably do another Ask Us Anything episode somewhere way down the line again, but we're going to have a lot of fun today with some of your questions. So I'm going to go ahead and start right out with one of the first ones we've received. I mean, like right off the bat, when we put out these feelers out for questions, I put it out on the newsletter first and then out on social media.
Right.
And one of the first people to respond to us, I believe he does subscribe to the newsletter, as a matter of fact. He emailed us. His name is Chris. And he had three questions for us.
Oh,
so,
man.
Yeah, this is going to be a lot of fun. So number one, he said, have you read any Disney comics? And if so, what was your favorite? Michelle, can you think of any Disney comics you might have read either recently or as you were growing up?
I guess, yeah, probably did when I was growing up too. But the more recent one, I can't remember exactly the title of it. It was one of DuckTales. And it was one that we picked up when we were at, I believe it was D23.
We picked that up at Comic-Con.
Oh, that's right.
Remember we went to the DuckTales panel?
Oh, yeah.
At Comic-Con.
That's right.
You know, and they were talking about how this was before the new version of DuckTales was released.
Right.
And they were describing how they're going to make it look so much like the comics. And they were releasing that comic. Just, matter of fact, the premiere edition of the new DuckTales comics were out at that time.
Right. That's true. That's true. But it also did interest me. I know I went to one of the booths. So I guess it was at Comic-Con too, though, and actually bought another comic of Donald Duck. So I don't know if it was just that I was inspired from that presentation or whatever, but they were a lot of fun, and right. I love those comics. What about you?
Yeah, I'm sure I did when I was young. I like you, I read the DuckTales comic when that came out just a few years ago. I was really excited about that. Currently, I'm reading some of the new Star Wars comics that are out, especially the Darth Vader series. I'm sure when I was young, unfortunately, they didn't imprint on me any comics that I enjoyed a lot, except for, again, back to Star Wars, some of the Dark Horse comics and some of the Star Wars that were coming out in the 70s and early 80s. I read those when I was growing up, but I can't tell you for sure like, oh, I'm pretty sure there was something like some Donald Duck or some Mickey Mouse or whatever, but I can't like say, oh yeah, I remember this grouping of comics that right. I read or whatever. So I'm sorry. Unfortunately, I don't have a really good answer for that one, but
that's a great question. And mm-hmm. if any of you have recommendations mm-hmm. for us, we would love to hear what would be great comics to read.
Definitely.
Definitely. But we love and appreciate the different art styles, and especially with comics. I know that there were some other comic books that are not Disney that I have purchased and read with different, mainly because of the unique art styles and kind of how they address, you know, more common themes than what you might see in the past.
Yeah, and we go to Comic-Con virtually every year. And even though we're not true comic aficionados, we do enjoy it. And yes, the artwork, I think, in a lot of it is spectacular. And we right, appreciate really, them. And we yeah. will go to some of the panels just to appreciate some of the artwork we'll see and you'll find out about new comics and such when we're there.
Yeah, exactly. So cool.
Yeah, so let's get to our second question from Chris. And he says, what do you wish was on Disney Plus that isn't? I'm sure Michelle must have an answer for this because I know she's like, where is this stuff? I really wish it was there.
Right. I know there's some things that aren't there yet that are coming. The things that pop into my head right away, again, because you've known some of these questions and they're fresh to me. Solo.
Yeah, it's coming.
It's coming, but it's not there yet. And I think it's called The Boys. It's about the Sherman Brothers.
Documentary on the Sherman Brothers.
Right, really.
We were just looking for it the other day. Yeah.
Right, exactly. Really, really interested in that one. And I think it's not there is Pollyanna.
Pollyanna's not there, huh?
Really? We'd have to double check on that, but I don't remember.
Well, you've been looking for a lot of the classic movies. You like a lot of that stuff.
Yeah, you know, so I don't.
You would know better than I do.
Right. So. I have not done a search for Pollyanna, but when I've done, you know, looking at different genres and things like that, I didn't see it. I'm a big fan of Hayley Mills movies, so maybe that's why, but. That's the only one that I can think of.
Yeah. As for me, I would love to see. I mean, I know there's a few small segments of the old, like the old Disneyland television shows and the Wonderful World
oh,
of
sure.
Color
right.
and all that. I would love to see much more if they would delve more deeply into and bring back many more of the Wonderful World of Color,
right.
the Wonderful World of Disney,
yes.
all that stuff. Because I grew up around all that and loved. You looked forward to it when it would come on every
right.
weekday. Back in the day when we were growing up and there are only maybe five channels to choose from. So when you got something, especially as a kid, you know, I mean, any cartoons that came on, like now kids get so lucky because you can watch cartoons anytime you want. There's a Cartoon Network.
Right.
There are so many different channels you can pick from, all the Disney channels that have cartoons on all the time. But when you were a kid, there were only so many times when you actually got to watch kids related shows
true.
And cartoons. And when something that was so family oriented as, you know, the Wonderful World of Color or the Wonderful World of Disney or all that came on, you just huddled around the TV and just really got a kick out of it. And I would love to just kind of relive my childhood by having some more of those pop back in.
That's a good point. I have thought of some other things.
Okay.
Mainly from when Disney Channel on cable first came out, and that was a premium channel you had to pay for and everything.
Mm-hmm.
They used to do a thing, I believe it was usually like after midnight, and I've always been a night owl. It was called Vault Disney, and they would show a lot of these old films and things, and that's where I started kind of really appreciating some of the older classic Disney movies, etc. And Zorro.
Oh, there's a little bit of Zorro.
There's a little. There is one Zorro movie, which is like three episodes of Zorro that's out there. But and when we traveled to Paris, and it was a really rainy day, and we were getting ready in our hotel room.
It was a really rainy day.
Yeah, and we were getting ready in our hotel room to go out, and we had TV on. It was Zorro was on in French. But it had, you know, some of the regular series, and they looked in great condition. So somewhere they are. That would be kind of fun to have that. It's just kind of a quirky, funny thing.
Yeah, that sounds good. I love the Zorro. Even this, the one that we have that, yes, is a few episodes kind of strung together into one single movie.
Right.
Totally enjoyable. I would love to see some more of that as well.
What was the event that we were at that had Zorro Mickey?
That was at the, I think that was 90s night.
Oh, okay.
Oh, no. It was throwback night. It was the Disneyland After Dark throwback night.
Okay.
And that was where we got the picture of you. Maybe I'll dig it up and put it on the show notes, or at least on the website. Because it's a classic. It's something you don't get a picture of very often. Was Zorro Mickey. And he was just walking around.
I know.
Night.
I didn't even know that Zorro Mickey existed.
It's really cool. Really cool. So one more here from Chris.
All right.
He says, who writes the funky newsletter? Parentheses. I coined the funky newsletter phrase.
Yeah.
For you. Parentheses. Yes. Thank you, Chris. As sad as it is, that's me.
That's why
it's so funky. I am the one who writes the funky newsletter every week. Michelle adds some things to it, but I'm usually the one who puts it together and sends it out.
It's awesome.
Yeah, it's funky for sure. Yeah. Funky is a great term for it, Chris. Thank you for doing that.
Yeah, love coining that.
Appreciated that. So thank you, Chris, for those questions. Michelle, you have some questions as well.
We do. So Nate and Serena, who recently were on our podcast,
yes, well,
they're known as DVC Duo.
So great to have them on our show finally. They are such great guests.
And
you apparently like them as well because you downloaded that episode a lot. And it was definitely a great show for
sure.
Yeah.
Anyway, they're wonderful. And we want to promote their blog as well. Mm-hmm. But on Twitter, you can find them at DVC Duo. They said, outside of Disney parks, cruises, etc., what's your favorite place to travel to?
That's an interesting question. Let's see. I think, you know, we've traveled to a lot of different places outside of Disney that we've been blessed to be able to visit. Mm-hmm. I think early on when we got together, Hawaii was one of our favorites.
Oh, yeah, you know,
especially
right.
Like my son lived on the Big Island of Hawaii, and so we visited there both together and as I did to just visit him many times. But we love Kauai a lot. Mm-hmm. You know, it's just one of those places actually that we want to get back to sometime soon. We were just talking about it recently that we are going to get back to Hawaii at some other point. I really have loved our trips to Paris. A couple mm-hmm. of them have been really spectacular for us. Another one that was it rained, or you're just talking about it.
Right.
It rained more than it had rained in like 100 years now while we were with something else. Let's see, what else? I really love going. I am a huge fan, and we haven't done this with Disney yet, so maybe this will count. But I am a giant fan of Alaska. I think Alaska.
Well, this
is
question was
gorgeous.
Outside of Disney, so that would count.
And we've done that. We've cruised it outside of Disney with different cruise companies. I love Alaska. I can go to Alaska. In the whole Pacific Northwest, but especially Alaska, is just so untouched and beautiful and gorgeous and peaceful, and it's just a wonderful place and one that I can return to many, many times.
Right.
What about you?
You've named all some really wonderful ones, and the one that came to mind when I saw this question was Paris. Mm-hmm. Just love the uniqueness of Paris. Love the things that. The simple things that you can do there and really have an amazing time. Like we like to go to, you know, the market and just buy a baguette, buy some ham, some cheese, go to a local winery, buy a bottle of wine or champagne and go to a park and just enjoy that outdoors and just be amongst that culture. It's just so fun. It's so fun.
Mm-hmm. To expand on that a little bit, one of our favorite nights we ever spent in Paris, we just did exactly what you talked about.
Right.
It was a little, you know, prosciutto, some really nice cheese, mm-hmm. a tomato on a baguette. We made some sandwiches, brought them out with a bottle of wine, sat outside the Eiffel Tower while it was all lit up in the park and just sat there. And then off in the distance, we noticed that there was like this group doing these tango, you know, it's a group tango that was going on nearby. And it's just one of those memories that we'll always have with us of what a interesting and wonderful night. And the weather was spectacular.
Right.
And that we've had in Paris.
Yeah. Exactly. It was a really fun and unique situation. First of all, that the fact that you can go out and sit on the lawn in front of the Eiffel Tower, yay. Mm-hmm. But having a glass of champagne, it's kind of like, you know, Lover's Corner there. There's a lot of couples there and everything as well. But that you can do that right there. And then, like you said, and this was a weekday. I think I want to say it was 11
o'clock
at night. It was really, really late. And we're, you know, we're hearing this music start in the background. It's like, what is that music and where's it coming from? And so we went around, and it was around like kind of a corner from there. And you're right, there were tango dancers of all ages, of all skill levels, just enjoying a Paris night. Yeah. And it was not summertime. It wasn't like your typical holiday. It was just a weeknight, late at night, and they were really enjoying it. Yeah. And it was amazing to watch.
I want to say it was like around September. It was really had some unseasonably wonderful weather Paris at that time. I mean, it was reaching 80 during the days. It was sunny, just beautiful. The nights were spectacular, and we just had a great time. And I will never forget that whole trip. I mean, there's so many things that happened on that trip, because we also did a transatlantic cruise, not with Disney. And the weather, we were blessed with great weather almost the entire time. We got to visit Iceland, Greenland, all these different unique and interesting places. That was one of our favorite trips of all time, and we're bragging here, but it was, you asked what our favorite places to go, and those were some of our favorite places.
Yeah. So. And I would agree with you in terms of domestic travel, Hawaii and the Pacific Northwest. I know it's not considered domestic, but Victoria is a city that's
Victoria,
really,
British Columbia.
Yeah,
yeah,
that's awesome.
We love that place as very well. Matter of fact, we may have some plans to go there possibly next year.
We have something booked. Yeah, let's see.
Let's see. We'll see how it goes.
Yeah.
We'll see how it goes. All right. Now I have a question for you. This one comes from Keenan, who is, of course, part of our World podcast on Twitter. You can find them at POOW podcast. And here we go. Here we go. We were waiting for one. Here we go.
All right.
This may not be something you want to discuss on your show, but Rachel and I have always been curious if you have any faith-based beliefs. Michelle, I believe that you have much more of a story along these lines yourself. So let's get to how you grew up in your faith-based beliefs.
Right.
Faith-based beliefs, I can say it.
Right. And that's a great, interesting question. And so I guess I would say, yes, I have a Christian faith-based demeanor about me or lifestyle. I wouldn't say I'm necessarily the most religious or practicing faith-based person, but I do, you know, have my beliefs in a Christian way. I was raised Catholic.
Mm-hmm. Very much so.
Very much so. And so, but I am...
You went to Catholic schools.
I went to Catholic schools pretty much all my life.
You were taught by nuns.
Taught by nuns, yes. Although I never wanted to be a nun. but anyways, no, I was, you know, and it definitely provides some serenity and some strength to me having that faith perspective. I am not one that has any issues with other faith. Mm-hmm. You know, like I have gone to other churches, other religious churches with friends, etc. And I see the beauty in some of the others, you know, whether it be Baptist or Grace Church, you know, some non-denominational churches. I really just see the beauty of what a community comes together when you have that faith-based perspective.
Yeah. I agree with that. I was raised Christian myself, but I've never been a particularly practicing Christian per se, more than, you know, the big days, the, you know, the Christmas, Easter.
Right.
Per
right.
Se. We do, you know, my family is, it's been our tradition for as long as since I was born, and I'm sure well before that, that we would get around and on Christmas Eve, you know, before we did any real celebrating of Christmas or whatever, and read the story of the birth of Christ and everything. So, you know, I mean, it is ingrained in me. As far as myself, I appreciate everybody who takes, who is very much faith-based. You know, I just, because I'm not particularly so. What I will say that is that I'm very agnostic to it. I I believe personally, and this is, I guess, my faith. If my faith is that I don't have much faith. Now, my faith is that we as humans don't really know everything that is going on. And
right.
We can't understand everything. And that could be based on possibly there being a higher being mm-hmm, for that mm-hmm. matter. And I have no problem with that. However, my personal faith is I have faith in people. My personal faith is that I believe that people are naturally good. Mm-hmm. They're intrinsically good. And I have a lot of faith. I also have a lot of faith in energy. Like I feel like people give off an energy and that you, and that will be something that you can know right on when you enter a room, like, you know, that person,
right.
or when you meet somebody, like that person has great energy. I want to hang out with that
sure.
person. Or that person's energy really sucks the life out of the room.
Right,
you know,
right.
There are people like that. And I tend to levitate towards people that have that more bright energy, because I'd like to believe that that's what I have.
Right.
I don't know.
No, definitely.
But that's just kind of, that's kind of what I feel. Again, I appreciate everybody who has a faith, and I think you're amazing for it. It's mm-hmm. not necessarily what I do, but I think the church is a wonderful location. It's a wonderful spot, like you said, Michelle, for community,
right.
for people to get together, to do wonderful things together.
Right.
And most of it is all about love. And
right.
I'm a big believer. I have faith in love.
Love
well.
And so, acceptance.
Yes.
And
that's me.
Right.
So that is going to be, I wanted to get our toughest question
wow,
out really early on. Thank you, Keenan, for the toughest
yeah.
question we're going to get today. hopefully we haven't turned anybody off with what
right.
we talked about here, but most more than anything else, we appreciate everybody.
Yeah.
We love everybody, and we are very accepting of everybody and whatever you believe in.
Oh,
so,
definitely.
So, well, not whatever. There are some
yeah,
things.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know what you believe in, but all right. But most things. So let's get
all
back
right,
to Michelle. Let's get to your next question that you have for us.
All right. So this came from Will and Jalesa from Young Adventures, and Adventures with a Z instead of an S. On Twitter, they DM'd us at young_family_YT. And they said, we would like to hear about both of your earliest memories of Disney and also your earliest memory of Disney together.
Want me to start with this one?
Sure.
Early memories of Disney for me are all about Disneyland. I grew up here on the West mm-hmm. Coast, so I would go to Disneyland a lot. My mother would take me quite often would just enjoy the heck out of, I love Disneyland. Although one of my earliest memories is that I remember, and it's so funny because this attraction has become my favorite, or virtually my favorite Disney attraction, but I was scared to death of the Haunted Mansion. Like, I was a kid. I didn't want any part of the Haunted Mansion.
Oh,
it was
funny.
Like, you know, now I love it to death. It's so, maybe because I conquered that fear. I don't know.
Yeah.
It's just so funny. So maybe that's one of those early memories. But I love Disneyland. I loved everything about Disneyland. And, you know, we just talked a little bit earlier about, you know, the Wonderful World of Color and the Wonderful
right.
World of Disney. Those are some of my early Disney memories as well. As far as us together mm-hmm. With Disney, my earliest memory of us together with Disney is because Michelle, when we first got together, we were on different coasts.
Yeah.
Michelle lived in Florida. I lived in Southern California. And one of our original get-togethers for, you know, as we originally started dating was I flew out and we visited. This was my first ever trip to Walt Disney World.
Mm-hmm.
We visited Walt Disney World for the first time. I'd never been there before. So we had just a wonderful few days. It was just a few days, not a full week or whatever.
Right.
I think it was like 3 or 4 days there. And it's just a wonderful memory for me as our relationship was beginning to blossom.
Right.
And we had a great time in a place that I had never experienced before, but I'm happy to go back to very often and always with you.
Oh, thank you, sweetie. So. Likewise. My story is pretty similar to yours. My earliest memories of Disney were first and foremost with what was on TV, whether it be movies or shows or whatever. And in terms of Disney World being brought there, you know, as a kid and just being amazed and instantly fell in love with Walt Disney World and realized that that was a place I needed to go to anytime I could muster up some money, you know, or I should say at that time, my parents would take us. And it's so funny you say that because about the Haunted Mansion, because I just remember like that with my brothers, you know, was kind of the thing that my parents would, you know, maybe go sit down and, you know, have a soda or something like that. And we'd get to go in the Haunted Mansion and have a good time and not be with them. And, you know, just family, really nice. Related to yeah. family and fun. Mm-hmm. And it always became that. It became, you know, family, close friends, as a way of just sharing a fun time. And the same, you know, like you said, our earliest memory of Disney together really was, you know, that trip to Walt Disney World, you know, when long ago, far away.
Yes.
But yeah, that was it. And that was fun. It was fun being able to share that with you, to be able to really see, because I had been to Disneyland in mm-hmm. the past, but it had been several years since then. But at that time, Disneyland wasn't, I don't think they were growing as much.
Well, that was right about the time when they just expanded into Disney California Adventure.
Yeah.
So they just expanded.
Right.
I don't know when you went.
Prior to that, we got together. Prior to that, that wasn't opened. And, you know, but anyway, yeah, great question.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Thanks. All right. So on to the next question that I have for us. I actually have a video question from one of our listeners.
Ooh, yeah. Very
so,
cool.
Let's take a listen to this one.
Hi, Tom and Michelle. My name's Amanda, and I live in the Bay Area in California. Glad you're home safe from your cruise, safe and sound. But my question for you is, what is your favorite attraction at Disneyland? And what is your favorite attraction at California Adventure? It's going to be tough, but I'm excited to hear your answers. Take care. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Amanda.
Yeah.
You look adorable in those ears.
I know. Thank you. Thank you for taking the time to do the video question. That's so awesome. Really appreciate that.
Yeah, really appreciate that, Amanda. Thank you for chiming in and doing the time to actually do a video question for us. So that was great. So we'll start with Michelle. Michelle, you want to think about it and I'll go first?
Yeah.
Okay. So as we just talked about, Haunted Mansion is my favorite.
Right.
Now, Rise of the Resistance just opened recently at Disneyland. However, I have not had the opportunity yet to go on it there. I've done it at Walt Disney World, not at Disneyland. So I'm going to kind of exclude that at Disneyland right now until we get the chance to go and visit it and ride it there. I'm sure it's going to be pretty much the same. It's going to be awesome and it will become my favorite attraction. But to this point, I'm going to go back old school and just, you know, a Haunted Mansion is my favorite attraction at Disneyland. Especially, I like the fact that you go for half the year, a little more than half the year at traditional Haunted Mansion. And then you get that portion of the year where you get the Haunted Mansion holiday. And it's amazing like that, too. So you get that. You get, you know, it's the same attraction just in different ways. And I love both aspects of it. So that's my favorite at Disneyland. Michelle, now, what's your favorite at Disneyland?
Okay. I mean, it's right. This is tough because there's so many that I would put at least all even as a top ranked attraction. I agree with you in terms of, so what I would say is if we were going to talk about a holiday overlay, I would agree with you with Haunted Mansion, Nightmare Before Christmas. Mm-hmm. That I can't get enough of that attraction when that's going. And Small World too. But,
sure.
But well, if I have to pick one. But during the majority of the year when that's not in place, I would actually say Jungle Cruise. I just like the historic, quirky fun of the, you know, the corny jokes and, you know, the whole experience of the Jungle Cruise.
Yeah, I love the Jungle Cruise as well. It's an old school from day one. You know, obviously it's changed a little bit from what Walt originally intended. It's, you know, it's mostly the, you know, ride looking at the animals or whatever. But they realized, you know, in a few years, like, okay, you know, it's looking at audio animatronic animals. Let's put some liveliness into this. And then the skippers, they just make it. You get a great skipper.
That's right.
And you're going to have an amazing journey. Even in some of the jokes you've heard 100 times, but it doesn't matter.
You'll laugh just the same.
It's a lot of fun. So Great one. Okay.
All right. California Adventure.
Now, for Disney California Adventure Park, it's a little more difficult for me. I love Toy Story Midway Mania very much. I love Soarin', especially when it's Soarin' over California, when they go back to that, which they did again recently. I love soaring over California. But I think the one attraction that I will go back to time and time again that I really enjoy is the Radiator Springs Racers. I just, it's got everything you want. You know, it's got a little bit of a thrill ride to it. It's got the dark ride. It tells a story well. It's themed really well. Just going through Cars Land itself is just a lot of fun. So I think probably if I had to pick only one attraction to go on at Disney California Adventure Park, probably be Radiator Springs Racers. Although I guess, you know, if you're going to really talk about all attractions, maybe it has to be Frozen, the musical spectacular, because really,
that's a show.
Hashtag real men love Frozen. So maybe it's that. But you know, if we're going to just go with rides, I'm going to go with Radiator Springs Racers.
I love giving you a hard time about that. It is a great show for sure.
Yeah. Michelle, yeah, yours.
So I would have to totally agree with you on that. The Midway Mania is Toy Story Midway Mania is a lot of fun. But same logic that you used. If I could only go on one, I would do the Racers as well. I think that, like you said, it has the story. It has part of a dark ride. It has a little bit of a thrill, but it is so immersive. Mm-hmm. You are just there, part of the town. You become kind of like a citizen there temporarily. And that to me is also what makes it such a unique attraction, that you really are 100% immersed into the experience.
Yeah, I love it a lot. And it's one of those that I try and make sure we get a fast pass for, because you got to get a fast pass early for that one.
Right.
But I try and get a fast anytime we're visiting California Adventure Park to do it. And at night, it's a different experience if you go on it during the day versus at night. The night is really cool because it's, you know, the way it's lit up and you can see the park lit up really well when you're on certain portions of it. I just love it. So. Good deal. Thank you, Amanda. Right.
Yes.
Really appreciate
Thank you for taking
it.
The time to do a video question.
Yes.
So impressive.
Yes.
So awesome.
So Michelle, I think you have another question for us.
I do. And this comes from our great friends at Monday Morning Monorail Podcast, Justin and Samantha. Thank you so much for sending a question. They can be found on Twitter at I can't even talk. At Morning Monorail. Sorry.
Welcome to the podcast. That's me every week.
And their question is, what would your ideal cast member role be at either Disneyland or Walt Disney World?
I'm good to go. Wow. It's probably going to have to be somewhere within Star Wars Galaxy's Edge for me. You know, whether it be one of the people that helps bring about the creating the lightsabers. Mm-hmm. I think that would be a fun role to have, the people that kind of tell the story, the tale.
Right.
From what I understand, having never done it, but because I'm just, it's tough for me to. $200. I really want to do it, but $200.
Right, right.
But also, you know, I think someone on Rise of the Resistance, I think the cast members who play, whether it's the Resistance or especially the First Order, they are so in character and they bring so much to that attraction that I think I would love to be one of those cast members involved with that more than anything else. Michelle, what about you?
Okay. I kind of listened to your answer, but I was thinking while you were talking. So, but I like that your idea about the helpful people with building a lightsaber. Mm-hmm. I think initially my idea would be probably to say be an Imagineer. Mm-hmm. I think that would be super interesting. But I think if I really had to narrow it down, I would love to be Minnie Mouse.
No,
you know, and just be able to be out there with people and, you know, share joy, see their joy, see the kids' happiness, people of all ages who, you know, embrace their child side. I would love to be a character, and I think I would like to be Minnie Mouse because I couldn't be Goofy.
Why is that?
My height. I am Goofy.
You could be about
I couldn't be a character Goofy in the park.
Goofy shoe. That's about the height you are. It'd be perfect. So, I love that idea. I also was thinking about just as you were talking as well. And one of the drivers for the transportation on Main Street, USA, I think would be a lot of fun too.
True.
Like the little car or the horse-drawn carriage or whatever, the double-decker bus. I think that might be kind of fun too.
You
know, all sorts of new people on all the time.
That's true.
Plus you're going up and down. It's just a cool area, a cool part of Disney that, you know, most people just kind of fly through.
Right.
But you really get to appreciate it. So I think that'd be kind of fun as well. So,
nice.
All right. My turn.
Okay.
We have this from Scott, who hit us up on Instagram. You can find him at SD Woody on Instagram. And he said, Tom, so this one's specifically for me right off the bat. What is your most embarrassing moment with a live microphone? Aside for every week on this show? That's interesting. And now this is going to come up as part of another question I know is coming up soon. I was involved in radio for much of my career. Mm-hmm. Yes, I have hosted some shows and I have done some sports updates. And I think as far as some live mic embarrassing things, I think there's a couple things. First off, when you've done it a few times, it's bound to happen. First off was the very first time I did a sports update. I was so nervous.
Oh, I bet.
You know, I'm on a 50,000 watt radio station. I've been wanting to do it for a long time. And I was just all over the map. It was like, I'm so glad there's no recording that I know of that, because I was just such a mess through it. I mean, I settled down after that, but the very first one I ever did was a wreck. Secondly, there was one time, and I was what's called a studio coordinator. So basically I ran what was going on between the talk show studio and the update studio or whatever.
Right.
And my talk show host was telling me, he's like, you know, will this sports update person ever stop talking? You know, because he wanted to get back to his show. And I hit the button, because there's a little button you can talk back that's not on the air to tell him. Yeah, he always goes on like this.
Oh, it's no.
So boring. I hit the wrong button.
Oh, no.
I was talking to the update guy. I look back, I'm like, oh. So, not really a live microphone. It was more of an internal thing.
Sure.
But that was a really embarrassing thing.
Oh, how funny.
Me. So,
that's awesome.
Yeah. Anyway, that's a lot of fun.
Yeah. Good question.
Moving on to his second question. And he says, if you had to be quarantined for 14 days in a Disney attraction, what would it be? So I'm hitting you with this. This is the first time you've seen this. I've had a little time to think about this, so I'll answer first.
Okay.
We'll go right back to Rise of the Resistance. I think that there's so many different chambers and areas within it. I think that you could find some amusing places within it often to kind of check out and look at. That would be maybe my first choice. My second choice might be going back to another one of my favorite attractions, the Haunted Mansion, because I think that's also an area where you have lots of different areas to check out. They're a lot of fun. Plus, you know, I mean, you're quarantined, you know, the only thing people living in there really aren't the living. So you're, you know, social distancing isn't that important. So you can kind of hang out with the ghosts, you know, and okay. You know, it's not a big deal. So I think the Haunted Mansion would be a lot of fun. Michelle, what do you think?
You didn't pick the Frozen one that time.
Yeah,
interesting. Awesome question. I think similar to you, I'm going back to Jungle Cruise because, again, if you're there and you could have like different skippers and have different experiences, maybe even drive the boat, you know, things like that. You know, so I think just having some of that fun in that area would be.
Yeah. I mean, not only would you see the backside of water, you see the left side of water, you see the right side of water.
Exactly.
You can experience the water all over the place.
I know. But yeah, interesting question. I'll probably think about that later today and come up with a million more responses.
All these answers, we're going to be like, oh, why didn't I say this? Or no, I should have been that. You know, but this is what our answers are for right now. So very good. Michelle, what's your next question you have for us?
Okay, the next question comes from Camille, who we're so excited because she and her husband are going to be joining us for a future episode here.
Yeah, coming up just next week.
I know. Can't wait. It's going to be fun. On Instagram, she's at Disney Bound and Down and at Castle Bound and Down.
Mm-hmm.
And her question is, I'd love to know what you both do for work.
Well, I just touched on it, and it's a little tricky now because for, gosh, more than a couple of decades, I worked in radio more than anything else. I've worked in mostly talk radio. I worked in sports radio, as a matter of fact, and I've done a lot of things in sports radio, working, you know, as a studio coordinator, as I talked about, a sports update guy, reporter. Right. I've hosted shows, had our own shows that I've done. And a producer. I've been a producer as well. Later on in my career, I moved on to where I would work mostly behind the scenes, working on sound, working on commercial production, and what's called station imaging, which is kind of the, you're listening to 95.7, you know, The Flash, you know, so that kind of stuff. I would put together a lot of those kind of things, promos for the station.
And you were award-winning for that. For that work.
Maybe.
Yes, yes, yes. Multiple year award winner.
Yeah.
Yes.
Well, thank you. But unfortunately, recently, well, there's been a couple things. One, there was a gap in the middle because radio is a very tumultuous career to be in, where I lost my job. I wasn't sure if I was going to get back into radio. So I did take up studying to be a chef. We started a catering company. I went to culinary school and we had a catering company for about 5-6 years that we ran. And then I got back into radio. And then just recently, we're coming up on almost a year anniversary to it. The radio station where I was working at, due to some financial liabilities and everything else, they just folded up shop. It wasn't even a matter of like they changed formats or everything. I mean, the station just went off the air. So they left a lot of us without jobs. And because of some other reasons, that some things I was taking care of at home and some other stuff that's going on now, including this trip we went on, I hadn't went and really delved into getting a new job. I've put out some feelers here and there, including at Disney for that matter, about getting a job. But I'm about to delve back into it more thoroughly, so we'll see where that lands in a little bit. So actually, for me, I'm unemployed. That's what I want to say right now. My job is working on the Funky Newsletter and this and the Disney
and
Dishes blog.
And we have some other things in the background that, you know, not ready for prime time yet.
But let's get into what makes us be able to work and makes us be able to function, and that is Michelle's career.
Well, so my educational background brought me into nursing. I'm a registered nurse. However, I don't work as a nurse. I'm a manager. I'm actually work at a company that I'm an administrator for, a clinic that has primary care, pediatrics, dermatology, radiology, pharmacy.
You run everything. You run the show there. You are the little woman in charge.
I have first line authority, I guess, if you were to say that for primary care. But I'm kind of a resource for all the other departments as a kind of a go-to person. Yeah. So.
Now, she has a great career, does a great job working in the medical industry. And again, you know, my job through radio for the years, and even now that I don't have it, but for years, it kind of like brought in some extra fun money for us. But Michelle is the reason we able to get to go on fun trips, reason we can survive paying what we pay to live in California. It's because Michelle has done such a great job within her career, studying getting the education to do it, but then working hard and just being a great leader to put her in the position where she is now. And it does help us be able to accomplish the things that we do now. And it's all thanks to Michelle.
Well, thank you. You're being way too generous and too modest. There are a lot of things behind the scenes that you do that make it possible.
I cook dinner every night.
Well, that's awesome. You also go grocery shopping, which is phenomenal. I am so spoiled in that regards. And then some of the extra care that our son Scott, who has Down syndrome, has, that you really manage that situation so that I can be working the crazy hours that one would work on a clinic. So you're wonderful.
Well, not as wonderful as you, but thank you very much. Very nice of you. All right, back to me. I have a question from Taylor, who hit us up on Instagram. You can find her at Taylor Knight. She has three questions for us. However, the first one we just covered, which was what job would we want to have if we worked at a Disney park? We just covered that recently, so just a couple questions ago. So here's the other couple questions. Is it, if you could design a new ride for any of the Disney theme parks, what would it be? And that is interesting. I tried to, as much as I saw some of these questions, I try not to think too deeply on many of them. But I think, well, first of all, you know, I got to get an attraction to Frozen 2 coming up soon because, you know, hashtag real man love Frozen. I would love to see a more expanded attraction involving Frozen 2. But I think that one thing I would love, and I'm glad that this is coming to one of the Asian Disney parks, and I'd love to see it come to the United States parks, is something revolved around Zootopia, because I love that movie.
Right.
I think it would really function well for, you know, there could be shows, there could be different dark rides, you know, it would be really a lot of fun. I mean, we do get to meet Judy Hopps and Nick Wilde at Disneyland quite often, and they are a great meet and greet if you ever get the chance to do that. But I would love to see it expanded into an actual Zootopia type attraction going through, maybe you go through the various different, because you know that there's the different districts within Zootopia, Tundra Town and all the different areas that they go through, Sahara Square, and of course main Zootopia itself. I would love to see that made into some sort of dark ride or something almost like, you know, similar to what the Radiator Springs Racers or I don't know, but I'm sure they would come up something really creative, and I would be excited to see that within the parks. Michelle, what about you?
Wow, that's a tough one. I agree with you in terms of the Zootopia. I think that would have like an amazing ability to hit a lot of things, being more like with some of these trackless rides and how they could expand on that and really give you that, again, that immersive experience. And man, I'm stumped at a new attraction. I'd like to see some of the old ones come back sometimes, but I'm glad that they've, you know, added Walt Disney World, the Mickey and Minnie into an attraction.
I'm glad they have the Mary Poppins attraction apparently coming, which will be great.
So things like that. I hate to just glom on you, but I think the Zootopia is a winner.
Well, if you come up with another answer as we're going through these other questions,
it'll probably be at 2 a.m. when
of course.
I'll wake up and like, oh man, why didn't I say this? Can we edit this?
Tangled! It's going to be in the middle of the night, wake me up.
I know, I'm trying to, in my head, go through all the movies, and there's, you know, obviously a lot of things that, a lot of great movies that would, you know, lend themselves to being a great attraction.
But I think also rumored, and I think you would love this one, is rumored out there, but it has not been anything officially made yet, is a Coco attraction. I think that would be another excellent attraction, one to go through.
Yeah, that was my idea. Didn't I just tell
you? She told me that earlier, but she had forgotten. So I just wanted to remind her, refreshing her memory on that. Finally, she has one other question for us. And this is a non-Disney question, she says. It's favorite places in San Diego. If you don't know, we live in San Diego, California. Where do you enjoy taking friends and family when they visit? So I'll start off with one of my favorite areas in San Diego is just down by the waterfront, kind of downtown, Seaport Village, although it needs some love. I kind of enjoy Seaport Village and the place that it is on the water, on the bay. And then if you go a little farther to the north, you have the Midway there, the Midway Museum, which is a classic aircraft carrier that's been turned into a floating museum there.
Sure.
And there's also... there's also the Maritime Museum that has the classic, tall ship, the Star of India, and they have like a classic old submarine there, and it's a lot of different cool places to visit. And then, you know, just within steps there, it's one of the great things about San Diego is that whole area. There's so much to do because right there is the Gaslamp Quarter as well, and there's so many great restaurants and shops you can hit up there, all within just a small area. And it's also great if you're ever cruising into or out of San Diego, because it's really close. Also, if you're flying in and out of San Diego, for some reason you were flying in and you had some time to kill, you could really almost walk from the airport to all these areas. It's really not that far. So, as a matter of fact, I used to run down there, and I used to run by the airport and through that area quite often.
No,
it doesn't take very long. So that's one of my favorite areas. Michelle, do you have some other areas you can think of?
Yeah, I mean, obviously there's a lot of the regular touristy places, but the San Diego Zoo actually has like a sister park.
That was one of my thoughts as
well. Really? Yeah. And it's called the Wild Animal
It used to be the Wild Animal Park. Now it's like the Safari Park, I believe.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
It's like
the
San Diego Zoo Safari Park is what they call it.
Right. And so that's, you know, it's kind of a lot. You're right. It is the Safari Park. You're brilliant. It is further away out on the outskirts of San Diego, which San Diego is an enormous city.
County.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. But anyways, it has, you know, a lot of obviously great animal ability to see animals more in their natural habitat. And it's also a location where they're doing a lot of conservation, you know, trying to make sure they're also helping support keeping species that are about to be extinct to stay available to us on this earth. So it is, it's great. It's really interesting. It's just, you know, I don't want to compare it to Disney's Animal Kingdom because I don't think it is like that. It is different. It's hard to explain, but I just find it's just very impressive and a lot of fun, and you feel good when you're there.
Right. It's a great place to get to. It's a little more difficult if you don't like have a rental car because it is out of the county a little bit. If you're just kind of staying downtown San Diego, it is a trek to get there.
Right.
Easy to get to the San Diego Zoo, which is also a great visit. It's you know, it's world renowned as a wonderful zoo. It's arguably the best zoo in the United States. You know, I mean, it's definitely in the top two or three for sure. So that's a great visit. But the Safari Park, what used to be called the Wild Animal Park, is different. It's you know, the San Diego Zoo runs it,
right,
but it's done in a different way. That's great. Also, Balboa Park is a great place to visit.
That.
Some great museums to just kind of go through. It's just a great place to walk around and check out the sights. Coronado is a lot of fun. Mm-hmm. A lot of little restaurants, shops. Wonderful, really wonderful beach area there.
And if you go to Coronado, you'd be amazed at how it looks identical to the Grand Floridian.
Right. The Coronado Hotel is actually the Grand Floridian was made based on the Coronado Hotel. And I like Carlsbad too. Kind of much of the coast is great. I really like Carlsbad, which is more northern coastal area. Before you get to Orange County, it's got a beautiful little town area there and some really nice beaches as well. And it's kind of just a fun place to visit. You can hop on a little train and take you up there, and or the what we have is called the Coaster, which is kind of a commuter train, and it's just a really easy jaunt up there if you want to go check it out. It stops right in town. So some cool areas that
we like
around San Diego. So, Michelle, do you have a, I think I'm wrapped up except for I have one more question that I'm going to save for last.
Okay.
But if you've got a few more questions, I believe.
I do. So this one came from the guys at Conversations podcast. That's a Star Wars podcast that is amazing to listen to.
Pat and Charles
are
great.
Right. Yeah. They are hilarious too. I can't get enough. But anyways, their question is kind of similar to a prior one, but might spark some other answers. Is they said, we'd love to hear your individual theme park origin story and how it brought you together.
Ooh. Hmm. What? Origin story. Well, again, you know, I grew up going to Disneyland. My family took me to Disneyland. My mother took me to Disneyland a lot. I've gone with my family, I've gone alone, and that's kind of where I grew up, was going to Disneyland. There's a few other theme parks within Southern California that I would visit it from time to time. There was a time in my life when I was more adventurous that I would go to some theme parks that had a little more roller coasters and stuff.
Look at you.
And now I'm quite a bit older, and I don't really need to go on those anymore, but I just love Disneyland for what it is. So that's kind of my origin story within the parks, was just getting to go there and checking them out and just enjoying the heck out of Disney and Disneyland. Michelle, your origin story.
Well, you know, as I mentioned a little earlier, is, you know, my first time going to Walt Disney World as a kid, I was just blown away. We hadn't ever done anything like that in terms of an experience of a park or anything like that. And, my family was from very modest means, and it was just mind-blowing to me how wonderful of a place it was, and that as I continued, you know, to age and grow and everything, I just continued to love it. I think part of what brought some of the togetherness of us is, well, one obviously was having the ability to to let you experience Walt Disney World for the first time, which is always a fun experience. But also, I had gone to Disneyland a few times. I think it was like maybe three times prior to when we had met. And as much as I kept trying to tell myself, I really appreciate the history behind it, the fact that it was so unique when it did come out, there were so many things about it that I wasn't as thrilled because I was very much influenced by the glitz and glamour of Walt Disney World, that I couldn't necessarily have the same appreciation for Disneyland. And when you brought me to Disneyland and we kind of experienced some of that together and you know, kind of broadened my scope of saying, don't try to compare it. See the benefit of what this is or see the beauty in this particular thing and the fact that, you know, these things are things that were here when Walt, who originated it, you know, happened. And again, I, in my mind had thought that, but really being able to experience that with you gave me a much better appreciation for Disneyland, mm-hmm. you know, and I know that it has changed tremendously from back then, you know, but I think that that really has helped me appreciate this park here in Southern California. You know, that was the beginning of making me become really in love with it.
Yeah. And now you are really in love with Disneyland.
I am.
You
really
like Disneyland
love, yes.
a lot. Yeah.
Yep.
And we try and go as often as we can because we enjoy it so much. So many times I think Michelle will be like, you know what we're going to do today? We're just going to go to Disney. We're just going to go. And I'm like, well, okay, let's go. You know, it's totally on a whim.
Right.
You know, it's the blessing of living so close to it is that we can just get up and also having annual passes.
Yeah.
Just being able to get up and go when we decide we want to. So.
And yeah, I remember early on when we were first, you know, dating and et cetera and married, you'd say, oh, let's go to Disneyland or tomorrow we'll go to Disneyland. And it was like, oh, okay, that's nice. But now I still get the, oh, I don't think I can sleep tonight because I'm thinking about all the things we could do at Disneyland or what we're going to eat. Right. Da, 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 da. So
the funny thing about all this is that, yes, I, you know, Michelle, as we mentioned earlier, you know, took me for my first trip to Walt Disney World. It wasn't her first trip to Disneyland, but I opened her eyes to what the joy is of Disneyland mm-hmm. as well. But the real theme park that kind of brought us together was really, it's not really a theme park, although you could consider it an adult theme park. And that was Las Vegas, because that was like one of the first things that kind of connected us. And
that's a good point.
You know, if we were going to get into the story of how we met, if you don't know how we met, we met online and not like through a dating site. We were not going through a dating site. It was random. Like Michelle was online with her sister on like Yahoo playing blackjack on Yahoo.
We were getting ready to go on a trip to Vegas together, my sister and brother-in-law and I.
Right. And as I told you before, my job was being a studio coordinator. And sometimes I would often be the studio coordinator for the sporting teams in town. So I was a studio coordinator for the San Diego Padres when the station I worked for had their rights. And oftentimes when you're doing those games, there's a lot of times where you're just doing nothing. So I would be online playing blackjack. And it was, you know, you just kind of chat between people and
right.
we kind of connected and talked a few more times and, you know, we just kept running into each other
right.
and
strange.
Eventually it progressed into something else and, you know, and Vegas was a part of that
right.
because of all of this. So it's not really a theme park, but in a way it's kind of,
yeah,
Vegas, it's
that's
kind
true.
Of a theme park.
That's true.
So that was kind of a part of our origin story of how we got together. It's a really funny way that
yeah,
we
that's
connected.
In a nutshell, but yeah.
Yeah. But yeah, it was good.
Yeah. It was back in the time when you said you met somebody online.
Yes.
People would like, ooh.
That's scary.
Yeah.
Which was like yesterday. Because the same thing still to this day. But it was even more scary back in, this was 2001 when this first happened. So,
right.
Yeah. Yeah. So. Anyway, so, all right, I think you got some more questions.
I do. So this one came from Adam from the Mouse and More podcast, and that's a great podcast.
Yeah,
That has a crew that works there, which is cool. It's Adam, Liza, Chris, Mark, Bridget, Rachel, and Tony. Mm. And they can be found on Twitter at the Mouse and More. So they sent several questions. So the first one is, what is our favorite cruise, I guess, itinerary you've been on?
Well, I, it wasn't Disney. But we were talking about it earlier, the transatlantic we did. And we got blessed by some wonderful weather, which kind of helped this be a super special cruise. But just because of everything that happened on this cruise, it became probably our all-time favorite itinerary. And that was, we started, first we went to Paris, like we talked about. Then we caught the ship in Dover. So that's cool. You get to see the White Cliffs of Dover in England. We hit Dublin, Ireland. We hit Glasgow, Scotland. We hit Northern Ireland as well.
Right.
And then we hit Iceland, which was really interesting visit. Because the weather was so nice, we were a couple days ahead of time. We got to go to Greenland and go through this kind of fjord channel and just sail through this really peaceful, wonderful inlet and see glaciers and some of the land.
It wasn't even on the original itinerary.
It just because that they were expecting to be fighting more weather, but everything was so smooth. We were ahead of schedule. Then we went into Greenland and stopped in this this port where our cruise ship, was 10 times the amount of people who lived in this area, when they got off there. And there weren't any real shore excursions. They just kind of put on, they brought people from other villages into town. And they just kind of put on little shows. There was a church there. They put on a choir singing. There was like a kayak exposition. They did some dancing stuff. It was just a really cool experience. And it ended up in New York City. And we stayed there for a couple of days, saw a few Broadway shows. And just really, really wonderful experience.
Right. Yeah, you're absolutely right. There were a lot of great highlights throughout Europe. But what you're talking about was a true highlight, once-in-a-lifetime experience when we went to Greenland. And as you mentioned, they just had locals there providing some entertainment rather than having like what you would typically think of as an excursion that you're going to go on. Actually, the town closed businesses for the day for the cruise ship being in port, and they were able to...
In schools. They had all the kids out.
Yeah. And so they did. They had, some of the young, I would say tweens or young teenagers doing, traditional folk dancing. And like you said, the church choir, which was really interesting, it sounded identical to the choir that you hear in Frozen. It's that kind of melody and sound, but just seeing people, wearing their traditional colors and costumes and really trying to share with the people from this cruise ship what their heritage was about was just so phenomenal, so touching. And like you said, they had some people doing some adventures on kayaks, and it was just going around and experiencing people in this location that is very different than what we would normally see in our day-to-day life, and really get to appreciate that they were willing to come out and share that was just phenomenally, emotionally beautiful.
We got really lucky, like I said, with the weather. I mean, when you're on one of these transatlantic cruises, especially to the North Atlantic, there's no guarantee you'll ever even be able to, because it can get really rough at times, which we experienced in a eastbound transatlantic in 2016 on Disney. Although that was still an amazing cruise as well. But, you might not be able to pull into these ports in Iceland or for sure, but it ended up working out really well. And that was just I've never seen that itinerary posted again since we got to go on it. We were just very blessed that it matched up with us being able to go on it. So it just kind of was lucky, and that it was a great cruise. As far as like more traditional itineraries, Alaska, as I said before, I love sailing Alaska. I don't think there's any more peaceful area to be just on a cruise ship, sitting out on your balcony or just looking out the window. And if you know anything about Alaska cruises, they go through much of what's called the Inside Passage, which has been carved out millions of years out of glaciers. So they're very deep, but they're also somewhat narrow. So the ships can get through there because they're so deep. But because of that, there's also land on both sides of you, really, really close. It looks like it's right there. Like you can almost reach out and touch a bald eagle there. So you can just sail and see all this untouched nature going by. You'll maybe see some bald eagles. Maybe, who knows? Maybe you'll see a moose or a bear. Just a lot of times you'll see dolphins and whales and everything when you're going through there. And it's just so relaxed and so zen and so relaxing and so wonderful. And it's just, you know, it gets so away from the everything that, you know, the city life and everything. I mean, the ports can be a little bit touristy, but if you get outside of the ports themselves and go visit some of the areas, or just while you're sailing along, it's just so magnificent and quiet, and the air is so fresh and wonderful. And I can go back, as I said before, I can go back anytime. And I think it's my favorite all-time itinerary is just any Alaska cruise.
Right. No, that makes sense. And like you said, it's just so unique. There's nothing comparable to it.
But I don't think there's very many cruises we've been on that we would say, that was a terrible itinerary. Now, a lot of times we may like the ship more than the stops because we've been there multiple times, but we enjoy virtually every itinerary that we can cruise on. So.
Right. Okay, the next question that Adam posed is, what would be either your dream cruise or Disney trip you want to go on in the future?
There's lots of Disney trips. I want to get to the Asian parks or whatever. Those are kind of some of our bucket list things is eventually getting over to the various Asian parks and checking them out. We have been to Disneyland Paris and enjoyed that very much. Looking forward to getting that back once they finish their construction that they're doing over there on the new lands and refurbishing on some areas and stuff. We want to get to Aulani soon. At some point we talked about going to Hawaii. Aulani is part of that. We want to check that out as well. As far as cruise itineraries, I really want to at some point do the Norwegian fjords. I think that's one. I'd also like to do the Mediterranean, but if I can only pick one, the Norwegian fjords. If you know, price is no object. Well, if price is no object, I want to do a world and time is no object. I want to do a world cruise. But if I can just pick one regular itinerary, I think that the Norwegian fjords would be the one I'd like to do.
Yeah, that's interesting. That would be a fun one. I think my dream cruise would be going around the tip of South America.
Oh, yeah, I'd like to do that too.
You know, and just being able to experience that, you know, I think that would be a little bit more adventurous of a nature, and it seems like it would be really, really interesting.
Yeah, it's a longer cruise, just like, you know, the Norwegian fjords is a little bit longer. It's not like a 4 or 5 day cruise. We happen to tend to like longer cruises for many, as we, you know, we just got off this Panama Canal cruise a couple of weeks ago. When you're on a long cruise, it really, one that, you know, they tend to, the dollar amount tends to balance out better on the, you know, per day amount that you're going for. But also, like, you get to know your dining staff really, really well. Right. Like, after you've been on for, you know, a week or more, you know, you start to really get, you know, working with one another. Like, if you're on a 3 day cruise, you know, basically you're seeing the dining staff 3 times and then you go.
You know,
but when you're on there for, you know, 10 to 14 days, I mean, you really kind of get to, you're talking to one another, you're getting to know their stories, they're getting to know your stories. So by the end of the cruise, it's like you're almost losing a friend or family member for a while because you've been together for so long. And it's really kind of nice. And also, it's just nice, you know, when you're on vacation and you're on a cruise, and if you think of your traditional cruise, let's just say you normally do a 7 day cruise, which is, you know, still a long cruise.
Right.
But when you get to that 7th day, you're like, normally I'd be getting off the ship, but I have a week to go. It's so great.
Right?
You know, as long as you can swing it, it's not easy to swing that kind of vacation time. But when you get to do that, that is a lot of fun.
So, right. So he lists one more question, which I'm going to cover in the tip. I appreciate him coming up with actually the basis of what my tip of the week is going to be, where he said, please give a good tip to someone that has never cruised before. So I will cover that.
Okay. My tip is make sure it's right for you. Cruise is not right for everybody.
Right.
You know, I would start going for a shorter one first to kind of give it a trial, but do it with Disney. If you're going to do a short one, if you're a Disney fan, because Disney, don't go for a short one on like some of these other brand names. I'm not going to name them all, but a lot of those are just kind of like booze cruises, which is fine if that's what you want to do. You just want to go and drink for 3 or 4 days, but I don't think you get a real cruise experience on it, where I think you do with the shorter Disney ones somewhat. But make sure it's right for you. And then you can go for some of the longer ones. I think that's the big thing. And also, pick the cabin that you're going to want to be in when you go there. It's like, what am I going to be able to, you know, be on for 7 days and feel comfortable? Do I need a balcony? Right. Do I need a window? You know, what are you looking for on the cruise? I think those are the biggest tips for me is, you know, this is going to be your hotel room, your home for anywhere from 3 to 7 to 14 days, right, whatever the case may be. Make sure you're in the room that you want to be in for that amount of time that you can do everything you want to do.
Good. I'm not going to give any more now because it's my tip of the week.
Sorry.
I probably stole some of your tips. When are you going to, I'm going to be like you on the, when is he going to stop? He's going on and on. He's got my whole script ready. I'm just kidding.
Well, what Michelle has the best tip. Well, we're not trying to steal her tip. So anyway, go ahead.
All right. And one last question that we got from Allison in email is, she said, which Disney character do you most associate yourself being like?
Wow.
I know.
I'd like to pretend that I am like Nick Wilde, but I'm not really in real life. I like to pretend I'm like him, but I enjoy him very much. Goofy. I tend to be kind of goofy, I think. I'm kind of silly. Many times I'm Elsa.
Just most of the time.
Away. More often, though, I'm Anna and just, you know, barely stumbling by, but, you know, still work hard to try and get things, to do the next right thing or whatever. So, I don't know. I think I'm a kind of a combination of many different things. Mm-hmm. I guess if you're just going to pin down one character, I tend to think I'm just kind of goofy. So what about you?
Well, you know, I like you, a lot of times feel like goofy. I adore Pluto, but I can't say I'm necessarily like that. I'm not trying to sound egotistical, but I guess if I were to look at a character and say, what do I feel I most seem to have had a life experience similar, would be Tiana from Princess and the Frog. I mean, I think a lot of times, especially when I was, in high school and even through college, I was kind of more like, okay, you just got to buckle down, do hard work, get things ready for, you know, what your goals are, you know? And so I think it was, I was kind of like that.
You're almost there. You're working to try and get that goal.
Yeah, you just always, you may not always appreciate what's fun going on around you because you're just so focused on accomplishing tasks. Mm. And, you know, in some regards that can be good because it can help get you to where you're going. But in other times it is not good because you miss out on some really wonderful things. And I think that's, being with you has brought me to that, to say, yes, you do need to spend time to focus, whether it's something, on work that you're trying to accomplish, but you also have to have that ability to detach and really have fun and really appreciate the things around. And I think that's, what you've shown me a lot. And that's why I think, like when we're just talking about vacations and cruises, having an ability to be in a like a cruise ship where you're getting to talk to the people that are working there and hearing their story and connecting with people that you normally in your day-to-day life, you connect with the people you work, your family at home, but this kind of broadens that. And I really appreciate that you've brought me to that.
Ah, well, I'm happy to do it. And I think that I agree with you. And then what you've done to work like Tiana had to work to get the goal what she wanted to get that restaurant. And you've done that to get the goal to where you are within your career and what you've done for this family and everything else. But I would also like to say that there is one other character who you are very much like.
Olaf?
You do like warm hugs. If you've met Michelle, she likes warm hugs. So that is true. But for one thing, there's a certain character that tends to drift around you regularly. So that would put you to 1 point. You're kind of tiny. So that gets you to another point. And you tend to, have pixie dust with you wherever you go. So I think you're kind of like Tinkerbell, because Peter Pan, whenever we go to Disney parks, Peter Pan is somewhere nearby.
That's
regularly.
True. That's so weird.
You are tiny, as I've said before, and you do share your pixie dust regularly. So you're a little bit of Tinkerbell as well.
You're so sweet. Well, thank you, sweetie.
So is that it for your questions?
That's it. So I guess we...
I've got one more.
All right.
One more question here, and this is from Aaron, who you can find on Instagram @ It's _A_dry_heat. I think we may know this, Aaron.
Oh, I think
but
so,
But I think
too.
He was, I think this is, he sent this to the wrong person because he said, why are you guys so cool? You definitely sent this to the wrong podcast, Aaron. I'm sorry. We got mixed up. We are not cool. I appreciate you thinking so if this is really meant for us, but we are far from cool. But thank you very much.
Too funny.
And that's it for our Ask Us Anything episode. We really want to say how much we appreciate all your questions and how much you chimed in. And we're looking forward to, you know, of course, answering more questions in the future. And anytime you want
to. If you really want that. People might listen to this episode and say, okay, TMI or... Wow, I did think they were cool before I listened to this episode. And now I'm like, boring.
Do not raise our coolness. That's
no.
That's for sure. But anyway, thanks for everybody who's taken part. And we will do this again somewhere way down the line. But if you ever want to hit us up with any other questions at any point, we'll be happy to answer them off the air as well as on the air. If you want us to bring it up on the air for some different segment, we can do that too. And of course, you can always hit us up on our social media and email us at HyperionAdventuresPodcast@gmail.com. Okay, so that was fun. That was a little difficult at times. We had some interesting topics, but it wasn't as scary as you thought it was going to be, was it?
No, you know, I know that our friends out there in the Disney community are wonderful people. You all have showed so much love for us and truly appreciate it. So, yeah, I think what we're talking about, like I didn't want to sound too uncool. I want to keep some demeanor of coolness.
You are cool. I'm uncool.
No, not even. But it was fun. And thank you so much for participating. We really, really appreciate it. And if we missed one of your questions, we're sorry. But anyways, thank you.
Yes, thank you very much. So normally at this point, we'd be getting to our Disney stories of the week. However, it's just been kind of slow. So we're going to kind of skim over that portion.
And we've talked a lot. Holy cow.
We're just going to move straight on to our tips, our vacation tips. Every week, we try and give you some sort of tip that might help you on your next vacation, whether it be the parks, whether it be Run Disney Cruise Line, whatever the case may be. And we always start with Michelle, one because, well, she's Tinkerbell, but also because she just has the very, very best tip. So let's get right to it. Here is Michelle's tip of the week.
Thank you. And again, thank you so much to Adam from the Mouse and More for this question, because it really helped guide me in the tip for this week. And that has to do with, you know, having some ideas or tips for a newbie for cruising. And easily I could go on and on. I could make a whole episode or series of episodes on this. So I'll try to keep it down. I couldn't narrow it to less than four. Sorry.
There we go.
But they're short. They're short. And some of it you've already touched on. Thank you very much. And if you do sign up for the newsletter, we can give you some other helpful information as well.
There's more work for me.
I know, but I already typed it up. So
I appreciate that. Thank you.
I guess actually that's really not a tip. I don't know why that's counted as number one, but no, here it is. Here is number one. If you've never cruised before, obviously research is helpful to prepare you. So if you've never done a cruise before, you know, like what you said, you might want to consider, with something like a Disney cruise to be a shorter cruise. And kind of in line with that is if you want to save some money, you may want to look into booking what they call a relocation.
A repositioning cruise.
Right. A repositioning cruise. Duh. Anyways, so that's a cruise that's not like a round trip. It's really to get the ship from where it is currently at to another location that's going to do a series of round trips. So, for example, a short cruise that's, you know, like you can sometimes find them 4 nights or 5 nights are between San Diego and Vancouver. And that's usually getting the ship either up towards Alaska to do the Alaska series for a season, or back down to San Diego to do a little bit of Mexico before going back through the Panama Canal over to Florida. They also have longer cruises, like, for example, there's the transatlantics that we talked about, usually from someplace in Florida, Miami, to Europe if you're on Disney. And so what makes those cheaper is it's cheaper for the cruise of the per day because it's not giving you a full, what they would normally consider a full experience. You wouldn't be going to as many ports. And
especially on the transatlantic where right. you're going like 4 or 5 days just crossing the ocean.
Exactly. You know? So that might not be your first choice for the first time cruising, but maybe one of these shorter cruises that can have a little bit of fun experience. You can, you know, experience both the port that you're leaving from as well as the port that you're arriving to and have a little bit more time there, or you might just find one that's closer to your house.
And they do usually stop somewhere along the line. Mm-hmm. It's not like they just go from point A to point B. There are some cruises that do that,
right?
But a lot of times there'll be at least a stop or two along the way, like you were talking about the one to Vancouver from right. San Diego. That one will stop in San Francisco often, right. and also like Victoria possibly.
Mm-hmm. So, right.
You do there are some ports that you can stop off on
right. Right. The other thing to remember, too, if you're a newbie, is it is fun to plan some excursions at some of the ports. But you might want to try to figure out what portion of port days you want to keep to yourself as your pool day. You know, one, when you're at port, that's when most people are getting off the ship. So the pool is pretty empty and you can really have, you know, that kind of to yourself. Plus, though, more importantly, it does give you some downtime to relax. And we have found from our experiences, if you try to do excursion, even though you might have sea days in between, by the end of the cruise, you're pretty drained, you know, and then you're not appreciating as much of the experience to relax and have a fun vacation. So trying to get that balance of having some fun excursions, but also taking advantage of having, you know, maybe even just one or a couple days at port that you're not doing an excursion. Maybe you just want to get out and walk around town and come back on the ship so that you at least get off the ship for a bit. But, you know, don't feel like you have to do an excursion every single port. You know, not to mention that you save money by not doing that at every single port.
Yeah, we've gone to where we take cruises to ports we've been to numerous times. And often since we've been there and we've done a couple things right. there, it's like, okay, everybody's getting off the ship. Just like Michelle said, pool is wide open yeah. for us and we'll take advantage of that day to
right.
do that instead, rather than do an excursion we've done many times or finding a lesser excursion, you know, and just spending money needlessly. You know,
right. So. Exactly. And so my last tip would be to consider purchasing cruise travel insurance. You could purchase that directly from the cruise line, or if you're working with a travel agent, they could assist you, or you could do some research online to find something that would be suitable. But, you know, it's just something when you're cruising that it's good to have that in your back pocket just in case.
Yeah, mostly because when you're cruising, you're going to foreign ports, and if something were to happen, you know, on an excursion, or if you're just walking around town, you know, accidents happen. You know, you were to trip in somewhere and, you know, break your ankle or whatever the case may be.
Right.
Your coverage that you have personally, whatever medical coverage you have at home, may not work, or it's much more difficult to go through for medical expenses in, say, you know, somewhere in the Caribbean or right. whatever the case may be. So sometimes having this as a backup in case something happens, you know, is good. I'm not a big proponent of travel insurance for most things, mm-hmm. but for cruises,
right.
I am, just because of the fact that you are traveling to some, you know, interesting places and, you know, things
right.
can happen.
Right. That, or you could have a last minute family issue come up or medical emergency come up with yourself that you can't make the cruise and you don't want to feel like you've thrown all that money out. Or you might have some inconveniences if you are traveling and your luggage doesn't arrive on time. So, I mean, depending on what kind of coverage you get, you might be able to have some additional buffers there in case something unpredictable happens.
Especially important if you're sailing like during hurricane season, because, you know, I mean, sometimes, you know, it's unfortunate, but the cruises either have to cancel because there's hurricanes going through, or they change their itinerary, right, or if they shorten the itinerary, or whatever the case may be. So usually they will give you something back, the cruise line itself, for that, but it's also a good backup on, in that regard if something happened. I mean, you're perfectly safe on the cruise ships, even during the storms, and, you know, they will avoid, they want to keep you as comfortable as possible. You know, it's just like flying on a plane. They don't try and fly through the thunderstorm.
Right.
They try and go around it, just like what the cruise ship will try and do. They want passengers to be comfortable on their journeys. So they will change itineraries, whatever the case may be. And that's another thing. If you've like booked some shore excursions that are, you know, not with the cruise line, you know, if for some reason you don't make that port and you can't cancel that shore excursion, well, the travel insurance can help you in that regards often.
Right.
So depending on what policy you get.
Exactly. So, you know, again, the, you know, these, it's, this tip is ended up being a little bit longer. I could go on and on, but I tried to come up with some things that aren't necessarily always discussed in discussions of planning for a cruise.
Very nice.
Thank
As we
you.
Always say, Michelle has the very best tips. And if you're looking to book a cruise, hit us up. If you have any questions about it, we are happy to talk about cruising anytime.
Right.
We love talking about cruising. And Michelle is very good at helping people out with deciding what's best and how to get the best out of their cruise. So
Thank you.
Michelle. And that kind of leads into my tip really quickly too, because, you know, we just got done with a Disney trip just a week or so ago. And so, you know, what happens when you get done with a Disney trip is you get those inevitable Disney blues a little bit where you're kind of missing it. You know, I'm missing the Disney. I'm missing my Disney cruise very much. We just took a nap the other day. I'm like, I miss my cruise nap where the ship would just gently rock.
Right.
I miss that so much, but just Disney and life and everything. So I'm going to talk a little bit about getting more Disney in your life. And I'm going to start off, but this is a topic that was hit on by a couple of our friends out there. First, I'm going to talk about Nate and Serena, who we had, and they sent us some questions earlier. The DVC duo, they had a great blog posting about adding more Disney magic into your life when you're not at the parks. You should definitely go to their blog at dvcduo.com and read there if you want some more interest in that. Also, if you're more of a podcast, Part of Our World podcast teamed up with Matt from Love of the Mouse podcast, and they discussed that exact same subject. They have a great show on it and discuss many reasons and many ways that you can get more Disney in your life when you're not going to the park. So I would tell you to hit them up. By the way, Matt is one of the people who helped us design our hashtag Real Men Love Frozen t-shirts. Actually, he designed it.
Yeah.
We kind of had the topic. He had the design he's a design proficiency, so he put it together, pitched it with us, and now we're selling it.
Yay.
And you can get that, by the way. Hit us up if you want to get it. We have links all over the place to purchase those. We still have them for sale, so please get those. But that's one way to get it, you know. Get some more Disney clothes, and, you know, and wear those, and when you're out, you know, when you're around, you know, feel free to wear your ears on a day that you're not going to the park.
Right.
You know, listen to Disney music. There's always sorts of ways between YouTube and you know, on Pandora and Spotify and all the different music services that you can kind up different Disney music. We were listening to it just this morning before leading into our show with one Pandora channel that we enjoy particularly, because it has a nice mix of regular Disney movie music along with theme park music.
Yeah.
So it's kind of a nice balance there. We enjoy that. I would suggest, you know, just getting out there, and whether you're actually going have a trip planned or not, just go in there and every once in a while just go and start planning out trips as if you might be able to go on one. I think that's a lot of fun to, you know, start plotting out your, what could be your next trip. Even if it's not the most immediate one, just what can you do in the future? If it's a cruise, look at the cruise itineraries. Like, you know, I really want to do a Disney cruise sometime. Maybe 2021 is a possibility. Start looking at the itineraries and go through them and pick them out.
Or looking at the hotels.
Or looking at the hotels.
Resorts.
Right, and finding out what's great about them. Listening to Disney podcasts like us. I just talked about Part of Our World podcast, but, you know, hopefully you're listening to us. We've been putting out some classic episodes for you to listen to recently. You know, that's a way to, you laugh.
I'm rolling my eyes.
We put out our fourth ever episode, which was like, we were not on our best on our fourth ever episode,
It
was a great topic and a great guest. It was the life of a former Disneyland VIP hostess. Right. We had former VIP hostess from Disneyland, Nicole, joined the show and talked about her career there. And it's really interesting. And even though we weren't on our best, it was an interesting topic. And I do suggest you go back and listen to it. But, you know, listening to the podcast is a good way to kind of get that Disney. Disney Plus is so nice to bring all this Disney into your home every single week, whenever you want. Now, there's just so many ways to get Disney in your life. I really take advantage of that. Michelle, I think you have some ways as well.
Well, I mean, obviously things like Disney dishes or things that you can eat that remind you of the park. And this is just a promo for next week because we're going to be doing something really fun. But I'm going to actually be sharing a story of something my family did that involved helping us get through a really hard time in Disney.
Wow, looking forward to hearing that part of next week's episode. So that's it. Just get as much Disney as you can in your life. It'll brighten yourself up and it'll cheer you up from what are the Disney blues after you're done with your last trip.
I know.
They're real. I mean, it happens. You know, you miss it. It's not reality. Disney is not reality. You know, that's what it's meant to be. It's meant to get you away from reality, and it's a lot of fun. So when you get away from it, of course, you're going to have a little bit of Disney blues.
Are you going to do some Disney bounding for me this weekend?
Nah, am I not Disney bounding now? Who am I?
Oh, I'm ready for you to be Obi-Wan again.
Maybe we'll do that soon.
Obi-Wan. You're my only hope.
People are going to think that like this is like a dirty reference.
You know? No, you just look so, oh man, edit, cut. No, I just mean you look really so official as your Obi-Wan.
Sometime I'll break out my Obi-Wan.
There you go.
Costume again for the listeners to check out.
That would be a good idea.
Yeah. Anyway, so that's it for this week. Next week, as Michelle already mentioned, we have a couple of our favorite people joining us, John and Camille Cotton, who you may have heard they were on the show for a very short segment a few months back. They're going to join us for a much longer segment this time. We're going to talk about a lot of Disney-related stuff.
It's going to be fun.
That they have going for them right now. And we're also going to have a little game. Yes, Michelle, the game show host, is coming back next week. We're going to play a little game for them that's all revolved around the happiest place on Earth because they are very much Disneyland aficionados like we are. So we're going to have some fun with that next week. We're excited for it.
We are, and it's a game that you can play along as well at home, and we'd be interested in hearing how there's going to be scores. So we're going to be interested to hear people's scores and what level they get. So
that'll be interesting.
Yeah.
We'll definitely have to check in with everybody on that. And I know I'm going to be like, as always, falling way behind.
Anyways, I think people will have a good time. I'm looking forward to it and participating in it with Camille and Jonathan. They're so fun and so wonderful. We're big fans of theirs, and we're honored they're going to be on our show.
Yeah, it's going to be a lot of fun. They are a great couple, and we're looking forward to having some fun with them. So that'll be next week, and we're excited for it. So as for today, we appreciated you joined us. You can find us most everywhere you get podcasts. However, the best place to find us is on our own website, HyperionAdventuresPodcast.com. And while you're there, why don't you go ahead and just sign up for the newsletter?
It's funky.
That's right. It is the funky newsletter. Thank you, Chris. It is the funky newsletter.
But yeah, it is. You do a great job, honey. And it'll give you some advanced knowledge of things coming up. And it just gives us an opportunity to share some things with you. And as we've said a million times in the past, it's not where we're getting your email address and sharing it with anybody. It's just us to share our newsletter with you, and that's it.
Yeah, just to share more information about the Hyperion Adventures podcast with you. That's the only reason. That's the only thing we do with it, and that's the only reason why we want your information, just to expand this Hyperion adventurer world that we live in.
Exactly.
Also, please follow us on social media. We are on Twitter at Hyperion Podcast, Facebook, Instagram, and Pinterest at Hyperion Adventures Podcast. And if you ever want to email us for any reason, it's HyperionAdventuresPodcast@gmail.com.
Right. And what we would really, truly, truly appreciate from the bottom of our hearts is if you could tell a friend about our podcast.
Yes, please, please tell your friends. You tell two friends, and two. Every time I screw this up.
You don't learn. Yeah.
You tell two friends, they'll tell two friends, and so on and so, so on. I just need to slow down. I mean, we've gone so long in this episode that it's like, okay, got to wrap it up.
But yes.
Anyway, yes, please tell your friends about our show and any podcast that you love. It really helps everybody in this community so very much. So that's it. Thank you for listening to the Hyperion Adventures podcast. We look forward to sharing some time with you again next week. Until that time, I'm Tom.
I'm Tinkerbell.
Yes, you are. And we hope that you have a magical week.
Bye.